Good evening, everyone. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. In the last lecture, we spoke about the themes of this novel, and we talked about vulnerability and also providence, and we spoke about the affectation and vanity and hypocrisy or hypocrisy. Also, we took the towns and country, towns and country and chastity and chastity. These are the themes of the novel. And today, in this lecture, it is maybe will become the last lecture of this course of this novel. And we will speak about the symbols of Joseph and Rose. We will start with the. We have many symbols of the of this novel. We will start first of all with Joseph's birthmark. Birthmark. Joseph's birthmark. What is it? Okay. Joseph's birthmark. It is a mark from the birth. It is on the on Joseph. They know Joseph after that from this mark. Okay, Joseph's strawberry. Also, it is a strawberry birthmark. It is a strawberry. It has a shape like a strawberry. Joseph's strawberry birthmark is strawberry birthmark is a symbol of his true origin. It is a symbol of his true origin. Okay, this is a symbol for his or to his true origin and identifies him as the son of Mr. and Mrs. Wilson. They know that Joseph is the son of Mr. and Mrs. Wilson from the strawberry birthmark. Okay, it is very important to know that Joseph and Rose is in reality or in truly he is the son for Mrs. and Mrs. Wilson. Before that, of course, when he was a baby, he was a small baby, he was stolen from from the gypsies and raised by Mrs. Andrews. Okay, he raised from raised in or by Mrs. Andrews, and here in the whole play, maybe we speak about Joseph Andrews as a son of Mrs. Andrews, son of Mrs. Andrews. Strawberry is also a fitting symbol. Why it is a fitting? Why it is a suitable symbol for Joseph? Why it is a suitable or fitting symbol for Joseph and Rose? Because or since it is a fruit, since it is a fruit, and this is associated with summer, associated with summer, fresh and sweet and beautiful to look at. Is a beautiful to look at. Is a fruit. Is summer. Something good here. Okay, and beautiful. And we also we saw that Joseph is also sweet and beautiful. Is a beautiful man who is the magnet for female attention. He is magnet for female attention, and he is. Ripe for the picking, ripe for the picking, maybe like he's ready for the picking, like a summer strawberry, like a summer, he's likened here, likened the Joseph by the summer strawberry, okay? This is the first symbol, and the second one is Parson Adams crab stick. What is the drumstick that was holden by Adam or Barson Adam? We will see that it is a crab stick. Barson Adam is a fighter. Barson Adam is a fighter by nature. Okay? Therefore, he always hold this crab stick. Okay, Barson Adam is a fighter by nature, both in word and in deed. He is never one to back down from a fight. The crab stick is a cane. Okay, crab stick by itself is a cane. A cane made of wood from a crab apple tree. From this crab stick made by crab apple tree. يعني مصنوع من شجر التفاح بري. Okay, this crab stick, هذه العصا مصنوعة من crab stick made by a wood from crab apple tree. The symbolized for crab stick, what is symbolized for? Symbolized his virility as a teacher since he is middle-aged and also his skill in physical fighting. He is skilled in physical fighting and his strength and vitality. The crab stick is his weapon for choice when he has to defend the people who are in his charge. He uses this crab stick as a weapon. Okay. This is weapon for or of choice when he has to defend. He wants to defend the people who are in his charge. The third one, the third symbol here. Character names. The character names. The names of the character. In Joseph and Rose has a lot of symbol, and we will see that most of the character that chosen by Henry Fielding have something related in something he wants it. Henry Fielding use people's names. He use people's name to, or he uses people's name to create a broad comedy in the novel. As well as indicate character. For example, Joseph Andrews has a name reminiscent of the handsome and kind Joseph of the Old Testament. Okay. Here, the Joseph Andrews, the character which we saw in our novel is symbolized or reminiscent of a handsome kind of Joseph in the Old Testament. Okay, it is the same name of Joseph from the Old Testament, who is favored by his father. Joseph here in the Old Testament was favored by his father Jacob. Okay. His father is Jacob, and then thrown into a pit by his jealous brothers. The jealous brothers bit or threw Joseph in a pit, okay, and sold into slavery. Also, he sold into slavery. Okay, Joseph's identity is hidden. Joseph's identity is hidden in the Bible story. Just as Joseph's, or here, Joseph's Andrew's true identity is hidden. Okay, Joseph's identity is hidden in the Bible story. The Bible story, but also in Quran story, we will see that if you read the story, you will see that Joseph's identity is hidden in the story. And also here in the novel, just like Joseph is our character, Joseph here. Joseph Andrews, the truly identity is hidden. Also, the true identity here in this story or in this novel is also hidden. Both Josephs here, both Josephs in the story and the Bible resist the advances of predatory mistresses. Predatory mistresses. The two, also here we have some similarity between the two of Josephs. Two Josephs resist the advances of predatory mistresses. Barson Ab or Barson Abraham Adams has a name. Here also we will speak about another character. Barson Abraham Adams has a name that recalls the biblical character of Abraham and Adam. Here, just to make it another color. Barson Abraham Adams has a name, also it's a symbol. His name is a symbol of the what we call in biblical character.
Assalamu alaikum.
Abraham. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
حياك الله دكتور، الله يسعد مساك.
اهلا وسهلا
دكتور كريم، ما في غير انا وياك؟
Okay, no matter, we will continue and if anyone enter.
No problem.
Okay. Barson Abraham Adams has a name that recalls the biblical character of Abraham and Abraham and Adam. Adam is the father of mankind, as the person is the father of his parishioners. The person attempts to mimic Abraham in the obedience to God, and is much enamored of the story of Abraham's willingness to sacrifice his son Isaac. Other characters have names that represent their followers. For example, Lady Bobby, also Lady Bobby has a name or symbolized name, Mrs. Slipslop, Constable or Succubribe, and the like. The third one, okay, the third symbol here, the Aeschylus text. Aeschylus text. The text by Greek dramatist Aeschylus. This is a text by, like a book here. This is a text by Greek dramatist Aeschylus of Barson Adam. He was reading Barson Adam from this Aeschylus. Represents his learning as Barson Adam represents his learning as well as his vanity. He represents the learning and the vanity about his learning. Okay, there is some vanity in Barson Adam's and the learning from this Aeschylus, or this Aeschylus symbolize for this. Okay, the text also represents his overreliance on book knowledge. When the person accidentally throws the text in the fire, he signals his willingness to give a back seat to this book or to books learning in favor of he give a back seat or to this book in favor of paying more attention to what is in front of him. Okay, they mean that he want to look at the future, he want to put aside his learning and he want to learn something new in the life. Okay, he hear what is in front of him. However, However, his resolution is short-lived. This resolution is short-lived. Okay, this is about the symbols of the play, the Aeschylus text, and the characters' names. And also we have the crab stick that was held by Adam, and the first symbol, which is the most important one, which is the birthmark or strawberry birthmark. Okay. Now we will take some quiet, some quotes by Joseph Andrews. We will take first of all from the book one, some quotes here. The quote says that he resolved to give a loose to her amorous inclination and to pay off the debt of the ledger which he found she owed herself. Okay, you have here to remember that these lines said by the narrator, okay? These lines said by the narrator in the novel, and to know that the idea of these lines, this quote referred to Mrs. Libeslob. This quote referred to Mrs. Libeslob. They mean that she resolved it. It means that Mrs. Libeslob resolved to give a loose to her amorous inclination. This quote refers to Mrs. Stevensop. She is an older and very ugly woman. Okay, she is a very ugly woman. Here, Mrs. Stevensop, we said that that she is an ugly woman. Okay, the gentlewoman in waiting, the gentlewoman in waiting of Lady Bobby, like her mistress, Mrs. Slipslope, like her mistress, she becomes enamored of Joseph. She become enamored for Joseph or of Joseph. Although single, the narrator indicates that he is not virgin. Mrs. Slobosov is not virgin. Why? Then here, because she is not virgin, however, it has been a long time since she has had a trace, and there is no danger, because she is not virgin, there is no danger for getting pregnant, okay? If she dies, she dies, إذا كانت أو إذا كانت تتسكى مع with a man, a رجل, therefore she intends to satisfy her passion, she want to or intended to satisfy her passion by pursuing Joseph, Okay, she has no danger, for for going with Joseph and do anything with him, because in reality he is or she is not a virgin woman. Okay. The quote number two. Okay. Anybody can read this quote number two? Yes, Basil, if you want to read this.
Where, Doctor? Where?
Number two, this line, okay, just here.
Okay. Mr. Adams passed off and told me, okay, the Chesley is as great a virtue in a man as in a the word is not clear.
Yes. Man as in a woman.
Woman in. Okay, Joseph Andrews, book one, chapter 10. Joseph Andrews makes this statement in a letter. He writes to his sister باميلا أندروز هي تيلز هير ذات هيز ميستريس هاز فيلين ان لاف وذ هيم اور از اني كوز وات جريت فولكس كول فيلينج ان لاف شي هاز ا مايند تو رين مي هي كونتينوس باي سيينج هي هاز learned from the clergy man that chastity should be many
maintained.
maintained by both men, man and woman, and he person himself has never known any woman except his wife. Joseph intends to follow the example set by Pearson Adams.
Thank you, Basir.
كم معي دكتور؟
Okay, here you are responsible for memorizing that these lines or this line. Mr. Adams hath often told me that chastity is as great a virtue in a man as in a woman. Maybe I will ask you in the exam, who said this line? Okay, who said this line? The answer is should be Joseph Andros. Okay, here Joseph Andros said these words. Joseph Andros make this statement. Joseph Andros make this statement in a letter he write to his sister. Okay, he make this lines in a letter. He writes to his sister Pamela. Okay, Pamela Andrews. He tells her that his mistress has fallen in love with him. He told his sister that the mistress of Joseph Andrews fallen in love with him, or in any case get a great folk call falling in love. She has a mind to ruin me. Okay, look what he said here. She want his mistress, he want to ruin the Joseph Andrews. He continues to saying that he has learned from the clergyman that clergyman who is the Barson Adam, okay, that chastity should be maintained by both men and women. Here, Joseph Andrews, he believe in this line, he believe that chastity should be maintained by both men and women. And the Barson himself has never known any woman except his wife. Okay. Number three. Also, if you, Ahmad Sultan, want to read this or give them.
Yes, I can, Mr.
Okay. Yes, start.
Hi.
Yes, from here, number three, four, give them.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Good evening, how are you all? Forgive them as it is forgive them as. In short, it is to forgive them as esteem. Mr. Barnabas, Book 1, Chapter 13. Mr. Barnabas is a minister who comes to see Joseph Andrews after he has been told by the doctor that he's on his deathbed. Barnabas insists that Joseph forgive
his attackers. Joseph explains that he would want them taken and that if he saw them, he would want to attack and kill them. Mr. Barnabas said that all that would be lawful, but he still needs to forgive the thieves. When Joseph asks him what it would mean to forgive them, Barnabas is clearly clueless and can only repeat cliches.
Clashes, yes. All right.
Cliches.
Thank you.
Yes,
Thank
okay.
you. We have.
Thank you, too, Mr. Thank you.
These lines said by Mr. Barnabas. Okay, these lines said by Mr. Barnabas. They call for Mr. Barnabas when Joseph and Rose was dying or was about to die, and they bring Mr. Barnabas to say to Joseph and Rose some words. And what he said? He said, "Forgive them, forgive them." He wants from Joseph and Rose to forgive the ruffian who beat him or who stole him. He said, "Forgive him as it is, forgive them as," in short, it is to forgive them as a Christian. He want to forgive him as a Christian, okay? Forgive him as a Christian. This is what said by Mr. Barnabas. Mr. Barnabas is a minister who come to see Joseph and Rose after he has been told by the doctor that he is in his deathbed. He, Joseph, was in deathbed, and Mr. Barnabas come to see Joseph and Rose, okay? And he want from Joseph and Rose to forgive the people who beat him, okay? Number four, the quote, number four here. Here we have maybe Ahmed, Sultan, you are here to read this.
Yes, Mister.
Okay. The quote number four. Yes. Read here.
A good track is more acceptable to be a creator than a wicked Christian. Thought his faith was perfectly our author would at Sir Paul's. Well, verse on Adam, book 1, chapter 17, when Mr. Barabbas and verse on Adam being speaking about technology, Adam decrees creating types of methods, teaching that declare that the only way to, a person can be justified, ultimately saved by God, is a true faith. The more prices the crime, which provide much Christianity, is that the person's good works are preferred as a result of God's grace, and that without faith, God works are worthless. Adam's put forth in the radical idea that God prefer a healthy someone without Christian faith. The orthodox Christian who is weak, although his premise that there can be a weak orthodox Christian may be flawed.
Okay, thank you, Ahmad. Good reading. What we have to know that these lines said by Barson Adam, okay? A good Turk, okay, here is some interrupt, is more acceptable to the creator than to the creator than a wicked Christian. Wicked Christian. Also, though his faith was as perfectly orthodox as it was, these words said by Barson Adam when he was speaking with Mr. Barnabas, and Barson Adams began speaking about theology, Adams decrees certain types of Methodist teaching that declare the only way a person can be justified or justified, ultimately saved by God. The meaning of justified here is to be saved by God, is through faith. The more precise doctrine which pervades much Christianity is that a person's good work or performed as a result of God's grace, and that without faith, good works are worthless. Without faith, good works are worthless. This is some lines here, okay, that was argued by Barsons and or Mr. Barnabas and Barson Adams. Okay, just remember that these lines said by Barson Adams about the some methods or some theology or doctrine. Number five, the world is always on the side of prudence and would surely condemn you if you sacrificed your interest to any motive whatever. Here, the speaker is Leonora's aunt. He was speaking with Leonora. Okay, Leonora's aunt was speaking with Leonora and said to her this word: the world is always on the side of prudence. Leonora's appear in a story that digresses from the main narrative. In the story, he is engaged to one man. Leonora was engaged to one man, but later has the chance to be married to a man of a higher stature. She would like to throw over her fiancé, but thinks that he might condemn her for doing so. Leonora's aunt claims that the world will side with her for choosing what is opportune, what is suitable for her, what's opportune. Okay, here the meaning of these lines here, and this underline word that I would underline for it. Leonora's aunt claims that the world will stand for or be with the side of the man who choosing what he wants, what is opportune. Which point to the fact that many people, especially high people, are selfish. The high people here are selfish, wicked, and uncharitable. Okay, we reach to quote number six. Men didn't make themselves, and if there had too much ascendance in the mind, the man was rather to be pitied than abhorred. This word said by Barson Adam. When or what is the total for saying this? Barson Adam makes this statement to the hunter. He was speaking with a hunter, and he said to him this line for this word, he meet in the wood. He meet a hunter in the wood. Person Adam meet a hunter in the wood who claims he has no use for coward. He was speaking about, the hunter was speaking about the cowards people, or people who don't stand up to fight for their country. Okay. Recently, he has disowned his nephew. Recently, this hunter disowned his nephew in the army, who would not exchange his commission to fight in the West Indies. The West Indies. Person Adam counsels him to be patient with his nephew. Person Adam was speaking here to be patient with his nephew. People are born with a certain trait and tendencies. And if a man lacks courage, he is rather to be pitied than scorned. Right after his conversation, the hunter shows himself to be the biggest coward ever. Right? Yes. After this conversation, we will see that this hunter, okay, is a coward, or the biggest coward ever. Since he ran away rather than help a woman. There was a woman crying, okay, and Mr. Abraham Adams was helping this woman, or went to help this woman, but the hunter ran away. Who is screaming? This woman was screaming, and clearly in danger. She was in danger. This woman was in danger, as we saw before. And the quote number 7. Here we will speak maybe in book number 2, but just we will stop a little. We will take a break. We reached to the quote number 7. This quote said by the narrator. What the narrator said here? He said that high people signify no other than people of fashion, and low people those of no fashion. This is very important quote by the narrator here. He speak about the British class or class system in British. Okay, there was two group of people: high people and low people. Okay, here the narrator made this sarcastic comment. هذا التعليق الساركاستيك اللي هو ساخر. In a chapter on high people and low people, in which he provides a simplified explanation of the he want to explain or simplify the explanation of the British class system. This is a British class system, high people and low people. Okay. In his view, the two types of people, here the two types of people, which types, the two types is the high people and low people, are high people and low people, or people on, they also, he don't say here, here, as he said, the high people signify no other than people of fashion, okay? The high people is the people of fashion. This is the high people in the system class of class system in British. In his view, the narrator's view, okay, the two types of people are high people and low people, or people of fashion and out of fashion. The people of fashion or out of fashion. There is a fierce, there's a fierce contention, fierce contention. What we mean by fierce contention is a strong dispute or disagreement. Okay, contention. كان في عنا خلاف قوي between these groups. And each party avoids speaking to the other in public and considers the other group as almost outside the human species. However, those people on the cusp mean the highest of low and the lowest of the high find that they change their party according to place and time. This section on the class system is humorous, but also verbally ironic. This is a verbally ironic and can be read as a critical commentary on these manufactured differences between people. Okay, here it is important. Here it is important quote, okay, said by the narrator. The second one or the next one. Indeed, it is probable, Mr. Adam. Here we are reading here in this quote. Indeed, it is probable Mr. Adams had rescued more than Fanny from the danger of rape that evening. From the danger of rape that evening. Said by the narrator. Okay. The person here, just to explain these lines. The person who had been traveling with Joseph and Rose was temporarily separated from him. In this period of separation, he saved a woman traveling alone on the road from being raped. This man saved a woman from being raped, okay? And that woman turns out to be Fanny Goodwill. And we will find that this woman is the same Fanny Goodwill. The person and Fanny are then reunited. Person and Fanny reunited with Joseph at a roadside inn. At the roadside inn. And Mrs. Livingstone traveling back from London in a stagecoach, stops in the same place. He insists that Joseph ride back with her. Stop wants from Joseph to ride with her in the stagecoach, but he refuses. Joseph and Rose refuses that because he didn't want to leave Fanny alone, since he will not leave Fanny behind. Okay, he will not, or he didn't want to leave Fanny behind him. Slipstop is furious. He become angry because he had hoped to engineer a tryst with Joseph. Now that she has him in her sight. The narrator make this comment because in bringing the young people together, Adam has inadvertently prevented Joseph from getting into the carriage with the slipstop. The quote number 9. I choose in from this novel. Okay, maybe I we'll ask someone here to read, maybe Basil, if you are ready to read this quote by the narrator. Okay, Basil.
Okay, doctor. Okay. Was Ripton is a man of great degree from thought. He never gave up. He think he had always that word in his mouth. Narrated book 2, chapter 16. This piece of variable irony in which what is sold is the opposite of what is meant, and scarce sim is this word is not clear.
And sarcasm is uttered by
sarcasm, okay, by the narrator about Mr. Travers, persons, a fair man, and a part-time pastor who refused to loan a person Adam's 14 shillings, a clear his debt at the inn. The people in travelers preach and are afraid of him, since he opposes money and power, while person Adams attempts to bag the 14 shillings from some good Christian in the poor rich Joseph and Fanny Wade and the hostess, okay, at the inn explains that Travers has good characters and is always reputed to be a man of charity.
A man of charity, thank you, Basil.
Charity, sorry, charity, yes. Okay, charity.
Here, what we have to study or to remember that this line said by the narrator, okay? The narrator said, he was reputed a man of a great charity. Who is he? He, here, who is was reputed a man of a charity? He is Mr. Truliver. Mr. Truliver was reputed a man of a great charity. يعني زي تروليفر كان عنده سمعة حسنة بأنه great charity, أنه يساعد الناس بشكل عظيم, إحسان, محسن, تمام؟ For though he never gave, يعني على الرغم من هذا الأمر, for though he never gave a farthing, he had always that word in his mouth. He has always that word in his mouth. Here we have a verbal irony. What is the verbal irony? The meaning of verbal irony, when you say something and it is the opposite what you mean by that. Okay, this is, as we said, it is a verbal irony. It's the verbal irony. It's said by the narrator, and it is a sarcasm also. Is verbal irony and is a sarcasm uttered by the narrator about trolley bar, about this said about the trolley bar. And who is trolley bar? Trolley bar is a prosperous farmer, and part-time pastor who refused to, this man, trolley bar, refused to loan Barson Adam 40 shilling, okay? Yes, he refused to loan Barson Adams 14 shillings. How he refused to loan Barson Adams the 14 shillings, and he is a man of charity, or a man of a great charity, okay? There is something here opposite of what we said, right? Okay, number 10. Here also about the narrator. Maybe Ihab, if you can to read this part. Just number.
Yes, Mr. Sorry. Yes, Mr. Sorry. Which part
here,
you
number
said?
10, he thought.
Okay.
Schoolmaster.
He thought schoolmaster the greatest character in the world and himself the greatest of all schoolmasters. Yes. Narrator, book 3, chapter 5. The narrator makes this comment about Barson Adams to point out that he is vain about his profession, as well as his particular gifts as a teacher. Joseph Andrews or Andrews and Barson Adams have been disagreeing over whether public school destroys the character of all boys. This is Adams' position. And he opines that someone like himself should have instructed Sir Thomas Bobby. The narrator says that if the person has a blind seed, it is this, his belief in his infallibility as a teacher.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Thank you too, thank you.
Okay. He thought, the narrator says that he thought a schoolmaster, the greatest character in the world, and himself, the greatest of all the school masters. The narrator makes his comment about Barson Adam. He speaks here about Barson Adam to point out that he is vain about his profession. Barson Adam was vain about his profession as well as his particular gift as a teacher. Okay, just this is the important thing here. And go to the number 11. Okay, maybe we have Ahmed, who can to read this from here. Are you here, Ahmed? Okay, maybe there is a weak connection with Ahmed. Okay, number 11. If goodness of a man's heart did not incline him to relieve the distresses of his fellow creature, me think the desire of honor should move him to it. Should move him to it. Joseph Andrews is the speaker here. The speaker here is Joseph Andrews. He said that if goodness of a man's heart did not incline him to relieve the distresses of his fellow creature, methinks the desire of honor should move him to it. Methinks the desire of honor should move him to it. Move him to maybe here the meaning here moving him to incline him to relieve. Okay, this statement is made by Joseph Andrews when he for the first time in the novel takes center stage, take a center stage and present his own view of charity. He make his own view, Joseph make his own view on charity. He is able to do so because Parson Adams is leaving. Joseph says he is not understand why he has seen so few instances of charity among people he has observed. His reason indicate that even if people, Joseph Andrews said that even if people don't want to help others because they feel genuine compassion, then they would help others just to look well in the eyes of other. This is the meaning of these lines. Okay, 12. I am surprised how much value mankind set on riches, since every day's experience shows us how little is in their power. The priest said this. This statement is made by Roman Catholic priest in disguise, whom Parson Adam meet at one of the inn. They saw this man, this priest. Okay, he's a Roman Catholic priest. They saw him in the inn at which his party stopped. The priest gives a mini sermon on the uselessness of the riches. His argument is that the riches have little power in the sense of what they bestow on their possessor. For example, rich can't bestow beauty. The riches cannot bestow the beauty or strength, intelligence or health. Riches in fact bestow many bad quality. This is what he believe. Okay, what the this breast what believe in these lines, and he said that the riches can't bestow beauty, strength, intelligence or health. Riches in fact bestow many bad quality, such as envy and vanity, such as yes here. And they can put people in danger or keep them in a constant state of worry, since they have to worry about holding into their wealth. We reach to the quote that I took it from the book 4. This is the first one, okay? About Lady Bowie, or Lady Bowie said that to avoid the censure of the world, we must ally ourselves to those we despise. We must prefer birth, title, and fortune to real merit. We must prefer birth, title, al-alqab, and a fortune or a laqab or unfortune or tharwa to real merit. Lady Bobby said that. Lady Bobby makes this comment when she and Joseph are back in the parish, and she once again raises her hope about getting into bed with him. However, now that he is part, Joseph is part of her family, because the brother of the niece, her nephew has married. She is thinking she might have him lawfully, but the last difference between them is still an obstacle. Lady Bobby complained that to maintain her place in the world, she must prefer people in her own class whom she despised to people, such as Joseph, whom she cares for and who have real merit, has real merit. Number 14. Also the narrator, we have a lot of quote said by the narrator, and this important quote: practitioners of deceit, who from having long deceived their acquaintance, يعني غشى الأكوينتانس المعارف بشكل طويل, long deceived, gain at last a power of deceiving, حصلوا في النهاية على القوة والمقدرة على deceiving themselves, على أن يغشوا أنفسهم. This said by the narrator. Okay, the narrator here speak about the statement, as he said, the narrator make this observation with regard to Lady Bobby. With regard to Lady Bobby, he means that over time, people who practice deceit, the people who practice deceit with others begin to deceive themselves. But how they really feel or think about something, okay, here's the meaning of the lines. Lady Bobby has confessed herself. He speak about Lady Bobby, who confessed herself that she despised Joseph because he has rejected her. Because he has rejected her. Okay, Joseph and Rose reject Lady Bobby, but in truth, he still is very much attached to him and is still burning to possess him. He wants Joseph, he is still want Joseph and Rose, although he rejected her. The last quote by Barson Adams: all passions are criminals in their excess, and even love itself, if it is not subservient to our duty, may render us blind to it. Barson Adams. This is the last quote we will study here in this novel. Barson Adams make this pedantic and heartless statement to Joseph when he is cautioning him not to love Fanny. He cautioning Joseph and Rose not to love Fanny too much. He said, don't love Fanny too much. Okay. كان يحذر جوزيف أنه لا يحب فاني كثيرا, lest his love eclipses his duty. Adam is repeating religious maxim. The maxim is something said by a wise man. Maxims that are based on the idea that reason is superior to emotion. The reason is superior, the idea that the reason is superior to emotion. And should be used to guide all decisions. Adams doesn't actually follow this rule. Adam himself doesn't actually follow this rule himself, but he is recommending that Yosef do it. He recommended Yosef to do that, to be the reason for all over the emotion. Therefore, he wants him to stop loving Fanny too much, because or he wants him to control his emotion over the reason, over the mind. Okay. This is all for this novel, and at the end of this course or this novel, I want to thank you for attention or for your attendance, for the people who was with me all the lectures. Thank you very much, and I hope you to get good marks in the exam. Thank you very much.